Yeah, so thanks for coming. Thank you for having me in the Kernel Summit. I know we had like there was in Arras Monday, and we had this talk is a bit more a follow-up of the previous talk we had in the referee track, where I discussed a bit Rust in general, like for user space, for Linux in general, the Linux ecosystem, and this one is the one focused on the kernel. We would like to have probably discussion. I don't know how much time, so if you want to have discussion, we can stop the talk at any moment and we can discuss, and that's completely fine. I will try to go quick on the slides to leave as much time as possible to discussion. But for those of you that were not in the first talk, I am going to try to give like a very quick right now summary of the other talk, basically going why, basically answering the question of why we want Rust in the Linux kernel first. And then we will talk about a bit, a couple of examples of how things work in the, or a couple of diagrams on how things work currently in the project. And then we can have the discussion if you want. So first of all, I want to give some credits first to Rust for being like a new approach or a new, bringing some new ideas to the system programming languages field. To kernel maintainers for having been patient and open-minded so far with us, or at least most of them. And everyone that has helped the project in one way or another. It's too many people. I can thank, of course, Wesson and Alex, which are the maintainers like me of the project. But there is also so many more people that have helped both from the, you know, from the kernel as well as external people from the Rust team, contributors to the compiler, etc. So thanks, thanks a lot. With that, since a few days ago was the anniversary of Linux, the kernel in this case, it's 30 years that Linux has been around in the world, and it's also for standards as well. It's more or less 30 years, so they go a bit together. Of course, not just Linux, also Unix goes with C as well, but and also in the kernel we don't use standard C as such. But anyhow, it was a nice, it's a nice coincidence that it's more or less they are more or less the same age. So talking about C and the kernel, it has not been always like a smooth story or trajectory because, as you know, well, we use extension, we have had our own differences on the memory model, etc., etc. So there is some things that we could discuss about the kernel and C. And here today we are trying to bring a new language to the kernel, right? We are trying to see whether a new language could be good enough, or the value proposition be good enough to overcome the costs that adding a new language to the kernel has. So is this an easy task? So Linus Torvalds was asked this a few years ago, do you see any language except C which is suitable for development of operating systems? And he answered, I have yet to see a language that comes even close to C. So with this sentence, at least some years ago, it was this was like a pipe dream, let's say, like something that is it would be very hard to achieve with for good reason. I mean, if C is good enough, why do we want something else? So why is actually good C for the kernel or for in general development or operating system, which is what was designed for, right? So Torvalds gave some reasons, which is one is that C generates fast code, which we all know about. It's low level, so we can map easily in our heads what is the assembly going to look like, and at least if it is not going to get vectorized or things like that. It's also a simple language compared to, for example, C++ or even Rust. So it's a simple language to understand and to build a compiler for. And if it's a domain, because well, it was designed for that. So of course, if it's a domain of writing kernels and other low-level tools. But there is a key problem with C, which is, and I will be very quick because this is basically what we talk about in the first talk, but I will go through it very quickly. It's unified behavior, as you know, all know. And what Rust offers, and I'm not going to explain unified behavior here in order to have time for discussion, but what Rust offers is no undefined behavior. And this includes memory safety, type safety, etc. In particular, when we discuss, and I put this here because I think it's important to clarify this from the get-go, safety in Rust, it doesn't mean safety in some safety critical sensor, anything like that, is no undefined behavior when coming from C. So if you come from C, you'll know what undefined behavior is. Rust basically says there is no undefined behavior in the safe subset of Rust. That is exactly what they mean, and we will see a couple of examples. And it's not related at all with safety critical. So for example, if you have worked on airborne applications or trains or cars, things that may kill people if or they may injure or may have some impact on actual safety as in functional safety, this is not related to that. So safety in Rust is not related to safety critical. Functional safety is more about requirements, traceability, independence of quality assurance, etc., etc. So it's completely different. You can write safety critical software in both C, also probably soon in Rust. There will be companies using it, Ada, etc., etc. So it's different and it's not related to safety critical. With that out of the way, why we say that avoiding undefined behavior is important, because yes, C has that issue in between quotes. He has undefined behavior. It's basically comes from the design of the language. It's not so much a problem. It's how the language is designed and how it's supposed to be used. Like it was designed as a, at least in the beginning, as a high level assembler, if you may. So why is important avoiding undefined behavior? And the reason is simply that there is 70% of the vulnerabilities in C and C++ projects come from undefined behavior, basically from memory safety, most of them. This, I have some, for this, I have some slides. We saw some data on this. So if you want more information, you can read this link. You can also see the other talk and the recordings. So you have to trust me on this so that we can go a bit quick here. So someone may say, okay, fine. Undefined behavior is an issue, it's 70% of the vulnerabilities, and safe Rust does not have it. But does that mean that using Rust actually helps with that? Because there are several questions that someone may ask. For example, well, if you have to use sometimes unsafe Rust, or a lot of times you have to use unsafe Rust, then perhaps it doesn't really matter. I mean, even if some subset of it has undefined behavior, doesn't have undefined behavior, if you have to write a lot of unsafe Rust, then perhaps the number of vulnerabilities is the same, right? Or somebody may ask, or may think, well, yes, it may not have the safe subset undefined behavior, but if this language is so complex that the programmer has to put more effort or make more mistakes per line of code, for example, then perhaps there are more vulnerabilities, even if they don't come from memory safety, perhaps they come from other sources, and then they offset each other, basically. So does it help? And in the first talk, we basically I made a poll on seeing if folks were going to guess this plot, basically. So look at the security path per project, the red part of the plot. This comes from is derived from this blog, which I explained on the other talk. But basically, from a set of projects, I didn't pick them, I didn't instinct, and please take this with a grain of salt, because what I did is from the spreadsheet that they published with all the security bugs and the bugs that they found, I just took the major language per project, I filled a table with the language, and then I plotted the numbers. So the average number of bugs and security and non-security bugs per project. And this is what it is. It's not normalized by, for example, lines of code or anything like that. So again, it's just a first order approximation, but I think the approximation is good enough because as you see here, there is no red part in the Rust column. So basically there were zero parts in this project, which is basically the Google open source fuzzing project, has zero, the fuzzers encounter zero vulnerabilities on the Rust code. Of course, the Rust projects may be too few, so not enough samples perhaps. It may be that, you know, there are many factors that can get into this, but again, as a first order approximation, I thought, okay, zero, because when I saw the spreadsheet, I was not looking for these numbers. I saw that it was zero. Basically, I saw some names that projects I recognized, and I said, okay, all of them are zero. Let's see all of them. So I went one by one, I created the table, and I found this, which I thought it was amazing. Of course, Rust still has other bugs, and of course, there are still bugs and vulnerabilities in Rust, even if this data has not found anything. But I still think. Again, I think it's a nice summary of that. So what else, apart from the non-defined behavior property, which is the key, and this is why we want it in the kernel. This is basically the key property of Rust. And other languages have the system programming languages that we could use in the kernel may or may not have this property. Some of them have similar properties, or they have a bit more lax properties, but the undefined behavior is the one that we really want. Now, Rust also offers other things as well. So it's important that we give like a quick, very quick overview of that. So Rust offers, it's like, you can say it's like a cleanup C, cleanup C++. It offers a stricter type system. It offers modules, invisibility, generics, lifetime, some types, a lot of things that we can take advantage in the kernel. So these are all things that actually, I think, the things I will put in these slides are things that I think are useful for the kernel, not just Rust in general. Then there is the free standard library, so the one for kernels, operating systems, as you know, bare bones, etc., embedded. I will answer the question. Francois, in your security comparison of languages, do you have data on number of lines of code? No, I didn't. I didn't go into lines of code for each project of that blog. Basically, the blog was something I saw. I saw the numbers. I saw that it was everything zero. There was no vulnerability on the Rust side, and I said, okay, it's very interesting because that plot is from 3 weeks ago. So and includes major projects and smaller projects, so it's a bit of everything. It's on in total is 100 projects plus. I encourage you to look into your talk, because I also asked folks before showing the plot. I asked them before showing the column of Rust. I asked them how many vulnerabilities you think the Rust column will have, and half of the attendees said 0 to 2, and they were quite correct. Some of them said no, a lot, like C, C++. Others said like Go and Python. So it was very nice. So the free standard library, as I was saying, I will try to go even quicker. It's basically the standard library, not the like the high level things or the things that depend on an operating system, but things that can be used without our operating system. These are things that we use in the kernel in Rust for Linux. And things like, for example, result and option are very important, because these are a way to handle error cases. Let's say the result is a way to handle error cases, and that is used by every single Rust project. So it's a type that is basically taking care of all the error handling, and everyone uses it. So no more taking care of what is an int, whether the return code is higher than 0, less than 0, equal to 0, whether it's, if it's a Boolean, whether it's true or false, which is the error case, which is the OK case, etc. So there are some things that we use and are interesting. In particular, also the checked, saturated, and wrapping inter-arithmetic primitives are also nice to have in the kernel. And we use a couple of places we use already them. And there is tooling. For the kernel, we already use a lot of this tooling. There is a documentation generator, a static analyzer, a linter, a formatter, etc. There is a lot of things. These ones are the ones we use. And of course, you can use GDB, LLDB, etc. with the usual tools, background in the case of user space, but the point is you can still use the normal tools with Rust code. So what is the catch? Rust as a language cannot model everything, so sometimes unsafe code is required, but much less than you may think, even in a kernel. So even in a kernel, it's very we can have drivers that are completely safe code or almost completely safe code, to the point of 99% of the code is possible to have, even when you are reading arbitrary addresses in memory, because we can take a register map and have the register map compute the addresses statically, let's say. So if we know the addresses on at compile time, we know them, then we can wrap those things into functions that do not allow you to compute any offset, basically. So the offset is pre-computed, let's say, or is hidden in the save function. So there is no computing any offset in the caller and then calling, for example, read B or write B, right, in the kernel. So instead of that, we will provide functions that have the offset already in the inside. So while unsafe code sometimes requires, it's less than you may imagine. There is more information to provide to the compiler in order to prevent some kinds of undefined behavior. This means a more complex language, so that's a catch, and it's more complex than C. There is some extra runtime checks in some cases, not in all cases. It depends on what kind of thing the compiler is trying to check. For example, out of bounds The compiler may be able, if you're using, for example, an iterator, or you are using something that the compiler knows what are the bounds, and you are not doing any like arbitrary computation of the index, then it doesn't need to check for the bounds, for example. So it depends. It depends. But even if it's potentially expensive in some cases, please recall that we have unsafe code. So this means you may write the majority of your code in safe code. And then even if you need in some whole loop, you need really some more performance in some particular case, we can use a line of unsafe code, for example, to perform an access or things like that, unchecked. Basically, they call it unchecked in Rust. So there is no check on the bounds, for example. And of course, the major one, and for the kernel, I think is the most important, is an extra language to learn. So it's some logistics and a maintenance burden. This is basically what we want to discuss today. Basically, Rust offers us some advantages, which I think are very important. Quite a few kernel maintainers have told us that they think is interesting, but of course, the key here is the cost. So there are two questions that we need to discuss later, which is, or during the LPC conference, which is, one is, do we actually want these features? Do we want this non-defined behavior language? And if we want, then how we are going to create a process or create some way to have a transition period to integrate Rust and give some time to kernel maintainers to learn the language. If you remember the slide from a few slides ago, we have what Torvalds was saying about C, and this is a comparison with Rust. So Rust, does it generate fast code? Yes. It's low level sometimes. Sometimes you can map easily what the assembly is going to look like. Sometimes you don't. You cannot map it easily because it depends. It depends on the kind of code you're writing. For example, if you change some iterators and things like that, it may happen that it's not easy to follow. It's simple, not really. This is a disadvantage, as we already said. And if it's a domain, I think so, because Rust was partially, or at least from my point of view, it was designed to replace C++ and C. So I think it fits the domain and is used already in some projects that we saw in the other talk that use Rust already for this purpose. So it's an easy task, maybe, because if you see here, Torvalds said this before Rust was a thing, or at least perhaps it was in the design phase, but the point is, Torvalds said this before. So I know this is a bit of a fun slide. I'm not meaning to say anything in particular, it's just for fun. But the idea is, when Torvalds or other people, not just Torvalds, were thinking about C and what could be done in the kernel or other languages, C++, etc., Rust was not there. It's quite new, but it's not as new as some people think. So I think it deserves a chance to be reviewed, to get into the kernel. And I think it's about the time that is right for us to get into the kernel. If you ask me 2 years ago, I would have said it's perhaps too early, or 3 years ago. If you ask me now, I think it's basically the right time we can pick up Rust for the kernel. And of course, compare, for example, with C++. C++ does not offer that key advantage. So if you compare it with other languages like C++, it doesn't offer the key advantage that Rust does. So there is some traders there. So some example, just to try to make it more concrete, and since I had to go very, very fast with that introduction, some examples where Rust helps. This is taken from the Cangrejos talk that we had last week. Some examples. So this is Compiler Explorer, many of you know. In the top side, you see Rust. In the bottom side, in the bottom half, you see C. Basically, it's equivalent code, or less. And what we see here is in the C side, which I am pointing at, we have a malloc, and then if the malloc allocation fails, we abort the program, and we write some number, and then we have a double free. So in the case of C, of course, several things may happen, depending on your optimization, depending on your compiler, etc., etc. In the case of Rust, as we see here, a double free drop basically would run the destructor, let's say, of this box type. A box is like a pointer, a unique pointer in C++, an allocation, if you want, like a box where you put an object. So if you try to drop the object twice, then you get an error, compile time error. But this is a very simple example, like the most basic example of how Rust prevents a double free. Of course, we cannot explain here all the mechanisms of how Rust does it in the general case, but what I wanted to show, sorry, is that this is actually prevented. Let me see the questions. What are the areas of the kernel that would make good candidates for Rust? Full disclosure, I played with Rust and made it to owner. Sorry, the chat is 15 to ownership and compiled Rust in Git. I like some aspects of it. So good candidates, it depends. If you are asking, for example, from the perspective of the process that we want to discuss later, from the perspective of the process, I would say drivers are the easiest in the sense that if a kernel maintainer is more or less okay with having Rust, or basically is on board with Rust and wants to have Rust on their subsystem, then drivers are like the key, not the key, sort of like the easiest way to put Rust, because we can write them, as long as we can write them with mostly a safe Rust, then that's the key, because what we want is safe drivers, so that we don't have to be always reviewing and always re-reviewing whether something may have a vulnerability or not, whether we are doing a double free, etc. If you are asking in general, not just like where Rust makes for good code in the kernel, I think everywhere. And this is not, I know it looks like exaggerating, but with the samples I am going to give a bit later, you will see that it actually offers some advantages in all kinds of code, basically, compared to C. In this case, we abort on allocation errors. How does one handle allocation errors without panicking Rust? So we in the kernel, we have, we discussed it with the upstream Rust, and we have now fallible allocations in the library. Okay, so the allocations, while this one is not fallible, the ones that we use in the kernel are. And upstream Rust is adding support for this. We actually upstreamed some of the functions that we needed, and we have some more functions that are fallible allocations in the kernel. And we hope that upstream keeps taking these functions so that we will get into that a bit later. So this double free, let me go a bit forward. This is another example. I will not get into this, but basically, as you can see here in C, if you follow my pointer, this is a use after free. We are using this. The program says the output is zero, but it could be different output, for example, a seg fault or a 42, depending on your optimization, your compiler, etc. And in Rust, if you try to do a use after free like this, you get, again, another compilation. Another example, for example, this is type confusion, or basically using an union with the member that is not the one that is correct. It's not undefined behavior in C, unless I'm completely mistaken now. In C++, it is undefined behavior. But the point is that even if it is not undefined behavior in C, Rust does not allow that with some types, with enums. Rust also has the unsafe equivalent, which is the union, like same as C, where you have to prove that you are not mixing basically reading one member that was not the active member of the struct, of the union, sorry. So there are also other features that I'm trying to show here that actually prevent this at compile time. And again, here is a compile time error. More things, for example. This is more, rather than an invalid code, this is more an example of like coming back to the question that Sua was asking, areas of Rust that the kernel can help. For example, this one. So see here, this is, in the top side, I put this, my mistake. I put C in the top. So here we have these two functions in C. And in the top one, get some data, we see that we have to put some comments, right? We have to put some comments in order to explain, for example, what is the success case? So what is going to happen when the success is, when the function is successful? So for example, result is going to be written here. So it's the output parameter. An int and this return value is just whether there was an error or not, and perhaps whatever, perhaps. So we need comments to explain this, because the type, the signature, does not tell us how that function works. While in Rust, and I'm hiding here some code because otherwise it gets a little messy, but it's just because in order to put the code in Compiler Explorer and have it compile, I'm using external function. But forget about that, it's not important, for example. Here, we have the same function, but as you see here, this takes no parameters, so there is no output parameter in this case, and it returns a type called result, which I mentioned in the free standing standard library in the slide a few moments ago. So here it means this function returns a result, so it can fail or not. It's a fallible function, so this already tells us it's fallible. And second, this type already tells us whether it's an okay or an error, so it already distinguishes those two possibilities, and you cannot make a mistake mixing them up. So there is no possibility of, for example, that somebody changes that the error is not zero now, it's a negative value, and now the success is a negative value. So this cannot happen in Rust. And it also allows us to put everything in the return type, because the result contains both the error case and the success case. So for example, if we want to return a number, like the int out parameter here, this goes in the first generic parameter, if you want. And the second one is like the empty type, because we don't want to have we don't want to return any error, basically. We don't want to return any information on if there is an error. So this already, with only the signature, I can already tell everything that was being written here in the comments. That's one of the things that, to show a very simple example that shows some features that allows us to really improve the code in the kernel, even without taking into account whether it's a subsystem or a driver or anything like that. There's a question, will type encodings be discouraged? For example, okay, I will let you finish the question, I will use it later. So this is an example of result, which is an example of a sum type. Now let's see, how do we build an abstraction? So we build an abstraction like this, which this came in Cangrejo, so I wanted to have a couple of slides on this. So imagine that we are in the kernel. Please imagine that we are in the kernel and we have some bindings here. So we have two functions, one that gets a pointer and one that that uses a pointer to perform some operation. So if you were to use this in C, calling these functions, let me put it this way. In C, there is no notion of safe or unsafe. So we have to, in Rust, we have to abstract this code in a way that there is no way we can trigger, the external user can trigger undefined behavior, right? So what we would do in the kernel? In the kernel, you would have something like this, not just in the kernel, in other projects as well, but the point here is having something like the kernel. So you would have a file somewhere that is abstraction code. You have a module, ignore this, it doesn't really matter, and you have a struct. So the pointer, instead of using the pointer in your function directly, but we will create and allowing, for example, drivers to call this, we disallow this. And instead of doing that, we have a struct that contains the pointer and contains it privately. So others, the people outside this code, this file, this module, or people outside that cannot touch this PTR. So then we have some methods, and this is a constructor, and this is the function that we basically another function that does something with the pointer. And you see here some safety comments, and these are comments basically that prove that manually prove. These are like the things that the compiler cannot check. Like for example, calling a C function cannot be checked. We have a coding guideline in the kernel that requires us to put why this is safe. So the proof, the manual proof that why it's safe. So for example, get pointer is always safe to call. That's a trivial case, so we call it, that's fine. And we get a pointer and we return the structure to the call. So for example, to a driver would be calling this function to get a foo, okay? And then we want to do something with the foo, and we can call this method. And calling this method, calling use pointer, we need to prove, because use pointer will access the pointer. So we need to prove that using the pointer is not going to, so the pointer needs to be valid when we make that call. So for doing that, we pass the pointer we have. But why this is safe? Because why somebody cannot modify that? And that's what so this is the example, the working example. I will go to the not working example because this perhaps this is here. So you see here, this is the driver, this grid, like some driver. And in the driver, we create this object, as I was saying. And then we try to modify the pointer. We try to put some random address there. And then we call the function. And this will break because it would call the C function eventually, passing it here, and it would pass a broken pointer. You see here, there is no unsafe. So in the driver, there would be no unsafe code. And we get a compile time error because we are trying to access a private field. So for example, visibility in Rust is key to provide safety guarantees and providing a safe interface. So this is a trivial example of how we would get a safe abstraction for a driver. And of course, the working code will be this. So if you don't modify that pointer, then it will work. And the compiler wouldn't complain, and you have the assembly here that, as you see, is what you expect, basically. So you basically have a call to the get pointer, and then a jump, well, it's optimized to a jump to use the pointer. In this, will type encodings be discouraged? For example, using a borrow check to enforce TDB term for context switching in KVM. Type encodings, in what sense, you mean? you can perhaps ask, or we go back later. So right now Rust is a client of the CAPIs. So we are not trying to like rewrite the kernel in Rust, let's say. Okay, we are not trying to rewrite that. What we are using is putting abstractions on top of that. So for example, we cannot play things with the, we cannot try to work with the workload checker across C. That doesn't make sense. What we do is create an abstraction on the Rust side, and then we have the workload checker work there. So for example, if you mean by type encodings, type wrappers perhaps of the C APIs, then yes, we would use them. So not discourage, quite the opposite. But I'm not sure I understood the question correctly. Yeah, so let's go ahead. So Rust supporting the kernel, this is very briefly how it works right now. It's open, still the design is open. There is no need basically everything that you see here could change in the sense that we are not saying this is the best solution. We are saying that this is the best solution we could find, but we could change this. But at least to have you, to give you some rough idea of how it works. So there is two trees here, the Rust tree and the Linux tree. This is the standard library, what we care about. We only use core analog, which are the library that we need. We have in the kernel right now, but this will be removed, a copy of the upstream Rust alloc crate, because we need those new functions that we needed to add to the standard library. As soon as the upstream gets those things, publishes a new release, then we can remove the alloc crate. Although I wouldn't do it right away, even if we have all the support we need, because we still want to have probably modify some things or add a new function. So it's better if we leave the alloc crate for a while inside the kernel so that we have more flexibility. Then we have here the kernel crate, and I saw online some people getting confused about the kernel crate. The kernel crate doesn't mean that we are rebuilding the kernel in Rust. The kernel crate means it's the abstractions for the kernel. Okay, so it's the abstractions of the C APIs. It's not that we are building a new kernel in the kernel crate. Then we have the binding, which is a tool that creates automatically the bindings for the C headers. So it parses the C headers and creates automatically Rust functions for those, so that it's easy to maintain. We don't need to maintain both in both sides. There is some limitations, of course. For example, C macros don't make sense to complex C macros. I mean, like not just a constant, but a complex macro that does something in C code. It doesn't make sense to use that to try to expand that in the Rust side, right? Yeah, that's basically it. I mean, the most important part, perhaps, to understand from a kernel maintainer's perspective, is this. So we have here three parts. One is at the right side, we have include binding, which as I said, I just said, this will be the bindings to the C API. So at the right, even more at the right, will be the C side of the kernel. Then we have the kernel crate, which are the abstractions, as I write here, of the different subsystems. This could be a split, this could be different crates. The crate is a compilation unit, basically, in Rust. It's a translation unit. In Rust, but doesn't really matter. We can change this, we can split this, it depends. The design of this is not, so it's not important that we put or not things on the kernel crate. What is important is the other thing, which is that the driver here will only ever call safe abstractions through this crate or set of crates. And the key is that you cannot call C functions directly from a driver. And while this may seem restrictive, is the key of having most of the code in Rust in the kernel be safe. Because if we allow this to work like this, then we will end up, it's my bet, that we will end up with drivers calling unsafe functions in C everywhere. I'm not taking the time to build an abstraction. So if we pay the cost of building the abstraction first, then we can have all the drivers using safe abstraction. And this is what we have been doing, especially, for example, Watson has been working on, for example, NVMe, et cetera, to create all the abstractions necessary to have some of the drivers, right? So this is the key that drivers need to do. And this is the work that kernel maintainers would need to work on. So the hardest part of this work, basically for kernel maintainers, would be the abstractions, because those are the ones that deal mostly with unsafe code. And unsafe code in Rust is the one that takes much more time to write and review, because it needs to, basically you need to know all the rules of unsafe Rust and also what your subsystem is doing. So for example, if you call a C function in the kernel, you really need to know what that C function is doing and what are the safety preconditions on that function. Otherwise, you cannot write the abstraction. So this is basically the hard work. And then the advantage is that then drivers or leaf modules or other modules as long as we have this abstraction, then they are mostly or almost all or even all, I mean, it could be all safe code. So we can actually drive write drivers with 100% safe code. Of course, there may be exceptions, or there may be a driver that does something that requires some unsafe, or perhaps there is a hot loop that you want to use unsafe for performance just in one single place. But So can you speak to Rust ownership as they relate to kernel resource ownership model? We had this question a couple of times. Rust ownership is on the Rust side. So you can think of, you cannot play with lifetimes in the sense of getting the borrow checker to work on the C side. So what we do is we create some type, as we saw, a wrapper that has some constraints on it or some invariants, and those are the ones that will be checked by the borrow checker. For example, if we use references on the Rust side, those will be checked by the compiler. But we cannot, there is no meaning, so to speak, of trying to mix the lifetimes, so to speak, of the C side with the actual lifetimes in Rust, like the syntactical lifetimes of the borrow or the borrows, let's say. My limited experience with binding is that it does not create usable bindings, and you have to create them by hand. Is binding now working out of the box? Yes, for us. For most of the things, there are some things that you need opaque types, or you have to basically you have a list that perhaps some of them don't work, but it's really few of them. So far, what we have used has been quite nice. So we don't need to write manually the bindings. There are still some problems that we discussed also on the other track, which is, for example, binding uses like clamp internally. So it doesn't use GCC. For example, if you build a GCC build kernel with Rust support enabled and you are using binding there, then binding is parsing the C headers using libclamp. So if clamp somehow computes different memory layouts than GCC, for example, if GCC is used in the kernel with a plugin that randomizes addresses, then, randomizes the order of a member, then you have a problem there. So there is some things that we need to discuss, but I think is does Rust code affect make all just config almost config? I mean, while there is no Rust code in a subsystem, should I be concerned about an issue with binding? I could break compilation on it.
Briefly, I'd like to add to what you said about the ownership model. So one thing that we actually try to do is to, even though we, as Miguel said, we can't go across the languages to use the borrow checker, but we do have two aspects of this ownership. One is when we are using C things, then we wrap them in Rust abstractions. For example, everything that is ref counted in C is ref counted on the Rust side too. And ref counted in the way that is done automatically. When the thing goes out of scope, then we decrement the ref count. And you cannot clone a pointer, for example, without incrementing the ref count. So we do have these things for file tasks and pretty much anything that is ref counted in C is also reflected in Rust. But we sort of do that manually. And we need to do that in each case, right? But the idea is that each time we find one of these that we need to interact with from Rust, we add these abstractions, and then this becomes available to everybody else that needs those same things. So this is one aspect, is when we are dealing with C objects when we are writing Rust code. We also have, in some cases, places where the C side is holding some state for us. For example, if you're implementing a file, drivers usually save this file, some file state in the private data field. Or when you have a driver, you have driver data. You have driver data on each device node, for example. So what we do in the Rust case is the abstraction that we create is such that the driver writers write something and then pass ownership to our wrappers. Our wrappers save this state on the C side, right? And then each time the C side tries to use that state, if it's like concurrent, for example, then we use a state shared. And then in the end, when you have a release sort of thing in the file operations, then ownership is transferred back to Rust. So we do have these manual instances where we try to make lifetimes mesh together between the two languages. But we do that manually. But the idea is that we do it manually once, and then everybody benefits from it on the Rust side. Back to you, Miguel, for the other questions.
Thank you, Wilson. Yeah, like Wilson said, this we have to, of course, for example, for red counts, et cetera, we have to keep those matching and in sync with the kernel. But what I meant by the lifetime, yes, is that we cannot use the borrow checker on the SQL. So everything we do is we have to use still the CP APIs as they are supposed to be used. For example, if they expect a call here and you cannot call then a destructor, for example, or a deallocation in another place, we have to follow the rules of the C API. But what I meant is that we cannot try to use the borrow checker on the C side. So you cannot just try to do that. But we can take advantage, as Wilson explained, of the borrow checker on the Rust side if we create abstractions. Which is the manual process that Wilson described. And Maro asked, does Rust code affect, what we do is that currently we have a fixed list of headers that we create the C APIs for. So whenever somebody new is coming with a new header, it's the highest chance of breaking the thing, basically. If somebody changes headers, it can break the ones that are already in the list. Yes, it could break if there is an issue with Bindgen. But we are using Bindgen, and that's one of the problems, basically. We are relying on the tool to work properly. So if somebody changes that, probably it will need to add into the blacklist or into the deny list. It will need to add those manually, right? It's a problem to use it, of course, on the right side, but you could also do it manually if Bindgen doesn't work. So here are the supported architectures. I will go through that because it's not that important for discussion, and I wanted to leave discussion at least until the end of the hour. So there is several compilers. If you were in the referee track, it was explained what are the three alternatives, the main one that we have. And then we have a GCC backend for the official frontend. And then there is the effort to put a new frontend completely from scratch on top of GCC. This is how the documentation looks. I will pass the slides meanwhile I try to read some of the questions. So this is how it looks. We can have also a discussion on whether we want to use this documentation or not. We think it's very, very important, or it's very nice to use this documentation because it knows the Rust code, it knows what are the things that are the features of the language, and it puts the documentation, generates the documentation according to that. So if you use Sphinx, we will lose a lot of that, I think, unless we create basically a Rust plugin for Sphinx that is amazing. This is also like LXR. It will be possible soon to click on all these names to cross-reference things. You see the code directly in the documentation. You can jump out in and out of it. You can do search very quickly. I think it's client-side. Yes, it's client-side, so it's through JavaScript. So you can even do something like LXR or bootlin Elixir right in the documentation. The documentation looks like this. It's markdown, basically, in the kernel code, and actually these code samples, the examples in the documentation can be run and can be compile tested at least. We could even runtime test. So that's very nice. It's a very nice feature, I think. We have committed some completion working, of course. This will be like the if devs or the ifs that we do in the preprocessor in the C side. So it's working. We have some very strict coding guidelines as well in the kernel. So as you can see here, I cannot extend myself much, but what we are trying to see is basically what we are trying to do is raise the bar on strictness, let's say, on the coding guidelines. So we are trying to, from the get-go, put very, very strict coding guidelines so that we don't have to do them later, basically. The abstractions will look like this. And I will leave that slide open while I read the question. Are there any reference kernel modules written in Rust available, actual some working driver? We have some samples in the tree that we test in the CI. There is also Wilson is working on the NVMe, and he can tell you more about that. on the NVMe driver. We also have the one that he posted as well on the GPIO example driver as well. And we hope to have more, of course. So yes, there is some actual working drivers already. No, thanks to you. This is how an implementation of the abstraction would look like. This is taken from the kernel tree, but our fork, I mean. Driver code would look like this. If you want to know more, you can go to this article, which is the one I just referenced, which is basically how it would look. This is the C side. And for example, here you see that we are computing for the write B operation, the GPIO and TCPIO driver. We are computing some address manually in the caller side. And that's completely unsafe, of course, on Rust, because you cannot know what is. If you pass an arbitrary pointer to this function, then you're writing to any place in memory. Instead, what we do is provide functions that contain already the offset. So, well, in this case, the Western world here, what we are doing is passing an address, and this function knows at compile time, it's able to check that this is not outside of the region that this object knows about. So this object knows about the size of the region, and if you go try to call something outside, it will complain. But in general, we can even abstract this even more and have this already, instead of having a write B function, having a write, for example, GPIO IS, and then we don't even have to have this parameter here. Testing code will look like this. We can discuss how it can be improved. Right now, we are testing this only on the host, but I want to work on this soon. So the idea is to have tests like native Rust tests and have them even working like key unit or self tests. So for example, at boot time, we can test this. So we could put an attribute here that says this test should be run at boot time, for example, and that would be automatically picked up. And that's the only thing you need to do to add a test to the kernel. Yeah, I want to skip that. And basically, I wanted to have some discussion on how to proceed from here, because the big question, and I hope during, well, this minute or the next, in the next days, we perhaps have a slot for discussion on this. It would be really nice if the organizers allow us to have an unconference slot, as I read in the webpage. So how to proceed? Because there is two questions. One, do we want Rust?
For BIO4, our keynote starts at the top of the hour, which will be Mad Dog. Oh. So if we could maybe wrap up in about 5 minutes. And there will be plenty of hack rooms, or maybe we can schedule a BOF on Friday. So that those might be the options if we want to do a follow-up discussion.
Perfect. Yeah, this is the last slide, basically. So question is in the what we would like to discuss with you, kernel maintainers and developers in particular, is how do we proceed? Because, for example, if you want to do, you're a kernel maintainer, you may be okay with Rust, but the problem is other kernel maintainers are telling us, yes, but I do tree-wide changes, or I do subsystem-wide changes sometimes, or I'm working on a driver, but I need to add a new feature to your subsystem. If your subsystem is using Rust, now I have to learn Rust. And that's a completely valid question, and we have to find a way to make it as easy as possible for kernel maintainers and other developers to have probably a transition period where we help them to maintain this code. But eventually, we want to have Rust as a first-class language. In the kernel, because otherwise it's impossible. It's impossible that we have a set of people working on the Rust side and a set of people working on the C side are completely separate. But the goal is that kernel maintainers accept Rust code in their subsystem, and that's and as soon as they do that, when somebody needs help, either us or the kernel maintainers, as soon as somebody needs help from the outside to modify that Rust abstractions, those Rust abstractions, we will provide help. But we could do this, for example, for 1 year or 2 years or something like that. But then eventually what we need is that the kernel maintainers and the developers are able to read and write Rust code. And I think that's unavoidable. If we put Rust in the kernel, we should do it as a first-class language. If we are going to do it like in a corner, I don't think that will work too well. Let me catch up with we have 3 minutes left. You think we need a set of Rust maintainers first? I can learn language for the new drivers. I need to. Yes, exactly. That's the question we want to see. So we have discussed of having Rust maintainers and having a set of people that can help basically anywhere in the kernel with the Rust abstractions. But in the end, we need people to get to learn Rust. We cannot continue basically forever with that. That would be the problem. So if there is any questions, sorry that I had to rush the presentation. It's a lot of things to explain. It's a lot of content to basically say why we want Rust in the kernel and why there's a lot of points to discuss. I wanted to make it as quick as possible, have discussion, but I understand that we will do it through the week. And if you are a kernel maintainer, let me just say, if you are a kernel maintainer, you are interested in Rust, or at least you want to learn more about it, please contact us. Because we want to have, the first kernel maintainers. We have, for example, GPIO guys, folks are on board with us, and they said, okay, let's try. We want to have more people that is willing to give it a try on their subsystem. So we need some users to put this in the kernel, and it's a bit of a chicken egg problem. To put this in the kernel, we need some users first, and to have some users, we need, So thank you everyone for coming, and thank you for having me here. That's the link of the project, and hopefully you can reach to us and discuss on. Especially if you are against the project, please reach out and try to discuss. And we need to see how we are going to make this, how we can make this happen if the majority of people want Rust in the kernel. Thank you.